Greetings. My name is Munesi Jeki. I'm from Orbit College in Rustenburg in the Northwest, South Africa, of course. Today I'm going to present a lesson in one of the most critical subjects, that is having everyone grow goosebumps. It's internet security. So as we know that the economy nowadays, it's based very much on the internet. Every business which is not on the internet, is really, really getting behind. So all sectors of the economy, we can say the economy is the internet is the backbone of our economy, of our modern economy. Trillions of dollars, trillions of transactions are done every day. But the subject of internet security is so big and so important and so complicated that we are not going to finish it in this presentation. So for today, I'm only going to overlook on two issues. The first one is the web attack technology. This is the technology that our hackers, our mischievous criminals, they use to steal information and to cause havoc, because they know that the economy is now on the internet. And another one, which we'll cover later, the second part, still under internet security, is called security equipment and systems. But for today, we are only going to sit and talk about web attack technologies. This internet security forms part of the level 4 multimedia syllabus, and it's 30% of the syllabus or the content, which means that is a very, very important topic. Students, you really must grasp this topic, otherwise you'll be found wanting in examinations. We are saying that it is 30% of the, 20% actually of the syllabus, which is equal to 30 marks out of the 150 marks at the end of the year. So this topic is very, very critical and very, very central to your success in multimedia services level 4. Moving forward, why do we have to talk about internet security? I've already highlighted that almost everyone, every citizen of the modern South Africa or of the modern world is doing something on the internet. If you are using WhatsApp, you are on the internet. If you are SMSing, you are using the internet. So if you are using a cell phone, you are using the internet. If you are shopping in ShopRite, in all this, you are using internet. So we need to understand that the internet, though very useful, it is being used by the criminals to commit fraud, theft. So whatever you do online or whatever you do on the internet, you need to be vigilant and to keep security in mind. With the use of internet security, the computer's internet accounts, the files, they are protected from intrusion and from unknown users. Because some users, they don't identify themselves on the internet. There's no need for people to identify themselves when they come to the internet, which actually increases the risk of fraud being committed. Because the moment people don't identify themselves and they've got a chance of accessing useful information, then it becomes very risky. Internet security, for it to fully work, we are looking at four aspects. Remember, we are just talking about internet security overall of it. Number one, internet security must look at penetration testing. When people are already in, they've already penetrated. This is the topic we are going to try and concentrate on today. The second one is intrusion detection. There is supposed to be a means whereby intruders must be detected. Not necessarily to be prevented, but just to detect that this one is an intruder. He has gone somewhere where they are not supposed to go. And then there's supposed to be also incident response. When there is something that is not right that is done on the internet, There must be a mechanism, the internet must have a mechanism to respond to that incident appropriately. We will talk about that as we go on. Finally, whatever we do on the internet, it must be legally compliant. Simply because we are trying to prevent fraud and theft does not mean we must break the law in the process. There are certain laws with regard to data security, with regard to what we do with people's private data that they post on the internet. So we as IT specialists or as security, cyber security specialists, we need to know that as much as we want trying to protect people, we must also remember that there's a law which guides us. It gives us limits on what we must do and on what we can do. Unfortunately, or can I say fortunately, this is a big, big subject, and many, many books and manuals have been written and prepared on this subject. So, as I said before, because of, at this level, we are not going to go into some of the critical topics. We are going to highlight almost everything. We need to go out there, get books on internet security, and study further. Let's look at if someone is a hacker, where do they start? Because we as people who are going to be building these systems, we are going to be working behind the screens. We are going to be working and programming and coding and connecting the networks. We need to know where does the hacker start from. When someone wants to commit crime on the internet, how do they start it? The first thing that they utilize, the criminals, they look for a weakness or a vulnerability in your internet or on your website. We are going to be talking about website in a moment, but I just want to highlight that the criminals, they don't just pounce. They first do a lot of homework behind the scenes to detect areas where you're having weaknesses. Now, because the internet is controlling the whole economy, it is backed up by many databases. And people who, you and me, who are in the IT industry, we are the professionals who are responsible for coding and programming these databases. We need to know that when we are doing a database which is going to go online, or when we are creating a web page which is going to go online, security, security, and security. No matter how good a program you have made, but if it is not secured, you are actually exposing the organization. So the very first step attackers launch is they start by detecting the weaknesses and use that weakness to their advantage. Number two, make sure, I cannot overemphasize this, I can repeat it a million times. Make sure whatever folder or file you are going to put on the server that is going to be accessed by the internet or by the public via the World Wide Web, it is very, very secured. Make sure all the files and folders are in a place where they are 100% secure and they can be monitored for any intruders. Any file, even if it is not a customer, it doesn't contain customer information, but if it is a file that is going to be used on your website, it must be secured. Applications that are going to run on that server, any application, utility software, the major softwares that are going to run your website, the auxiliary utilities, they must be secured. Because remember, the hacker has got all the time. And these hackers are not just ordinary, they are very, very highly trained, educated, and they can tweak around and program around their way to try and steal information. In this lesson, I'm going to take a narrow look and I'm going to concentrate on website attacks. How do our criminals, I'm going to identify them in a moment, how do they attack the website? In future lessons, we are going to talk about intrusion detection, prevention, firewalls, viruses, and all the other stuff. But for today, I'm going to look at a website which is up and running. How does a criminal, or as we are going to call them, a cyber criminal, we are going to define them in a moment, how do they gain access to that? And how can we prevent? How can we prevent? So website attacks. Let me repeat again. Website attacks are caused by poor website design and coding. The person who is sitting there coding and designing a website is the person who is responsible for making sure that when this website goes online, it has got security features built into it. So web attacks are caused by poor website design and coding. Your HTML coding, your CSS, your JavaScript, all the coding, your PHP, your Java, all the coding that you do for a website, they must be properly done. No shortcuts. Let me define this, what is called a cyber crime. It is a crime which is committed by the help of computers and networks. We have got a lot of Wi-Fi networks going around. We have got a lot of Bluetooth going around. Criminals, they know how to crack into those networks. So cybercrime is a crime specifically committed using computers and the very networks that we build. It includes hacking, phishing, and spamming. These types of crimes are committed by people called cyber criminals. They are people who wake up every day, they have been trained, they have gone to universities, they have got master's degrees, they have got doctorates in computers, but they don't want to work, they just want to commit crime. Because according to them, with their mindset, crime is beneficial to them. Because we, the people who build websites, we do so many small errors that they can utilize them and they get away with it. Cybersecurity, I'm just highlighting some of the words that I used, is a practice of protecting systems, networks, and programs from digital attacks. This is the best industry so far in IT. It's a growing industry. It was not there maybe 10 or 15 years ago, but now every company has realized that they need to secure their cyberspace. They need security when they go online. They know that hackers are hanging out there to pounce, to steal. So as much as they guard those cars which carry money with guns and armored, we need people like you and me who go for training to make sure that our cyberspace is secured. Because normally, the person who commits these cyber crimes, they don't come with a bomb or with a gun. They just sit in their house, connect to a wireless network, their laptop, sip their coffee, but they are stealing millions. So we need cybersecurity. The cyber attacks are usually aimed at accessing, changing, or destroying sensitive information, extorting money from users, or interrupting normal business practices. Implementing effective cybersecurity measures is particularly challenging today because there are more devices than people. You may not believe it, but there are more devices, many devices. When the internet started, the IP addresses were in the region about 4.3 billion. And all of us in the IT industry, we thought 4.3 billion is a big number. No one is going to exhaust it. But today in the world, there are more than 6 billion people and more than 6 billion devices, more than 6 billion devices. All these, they need IP addresses. I'm just trying to highlight how big the industry called cybersecurity is. So if you are in IT and you are thinking of an industry to go, cybersecurity should be one of them because the demand is there. The first one that we are going to look at, the type of attack, is denial of service attack or distributed denial of service attacks. We are going to discuss them in one go. Denial of service attack is the attacker does not gain anything. He's not going to get money out of it. He's just doing it out of just to disrupt the activities of the internet. They just know that they just want to cause havoc for no reason. How does it work? The attacker overwhelms your website. It appears as if too many people have logged on, which means now your website, if it is a bank, instead of it giving service to your customers, it will deny service now to the legitimate customers because it is processing too many. Let's assume when it was designed to service 500 customers at a time. Now the attacker makes it appear as if it's 2 million customers. Now when the real customer comes, they cannot be serviced because it's already overwhelmed. That is what a denial of service attack does. It overwhelms your website. Too many logons and it's overloaded. And when you try, say it times out or it refuses to log you in. Distributed denial of service attack, this one is launched from many computers. The attacker launches a program which from many computers and overwhelms the system. The end result is the same. The system will just block away the legitimate customers. The other thing why they do it is competition. They know that if we overload Bank X and the customers see that the Bank X network is not working, they are gonna go to Bank Z. So competitors also can do this type of attack just to make the other competitor look bad in the sight of customers. Because the customers, they don't know what is going on. So it is very, very important for us as IT specialists to be aware of this. Now, as I said before, the attacker in this case does not automatically, there's no direct benefit to the attacker, but he's satisfied just to see that there is havoc. He's satisfied. Now, if the attacked resource belongs to a competitor, then it benefits the attacker to know that their competitors are in trouble. Another purpose of DS attack can be to take the system offline. That is another one that the hackers do. They use it as a smoke screen. They connect your system, they cause a denial of service. You yourself, you can't access the server. Your customers cannot access the server. In the meantime, they are busy siphoning important information. By the time the system is restored, they've already stolen what they wanted. So a denial of service attack can also be used to block you from monitoring what is happening on your server. They are overloading it so that you can't log in to see what is happening. In the meantime, in that fraction of a time, they can download whatever they want. One common example is session hijacking. This one I would describe it a little bit later. Session hijacking. The administrator is administering the server, then a hacker comes, I will describe it later on. Number two, there's an attack called man-in-the-middle attack. Unfortunately, this one, at the moment, there's no solution. This occurs when a hacker inserts itself between the communications of a client and server. A client is logged on to e-banking, he's a millionaire, like Bill Gates, he's doing his transactions, and then a hacker next door managed to hack into his session. And then he managed to fool the bank that when Bill Gates logs out, he managed to fool the bank that he's still logged in. And he can transfer lots of money. And the bank will allow that because it has been deceived to think that. This is an example of it on that diagram there. You can see the victim has got an IP address, a legitimate one, is faithfully, unknowingly logged, connected to the server there. And then the attacker is sitting there. Just like a common criminal sitting in the darkness there, somewhere there. They intercept the session. He appears now to be the victim. When the victim logs off, faithfully logs off, because when you are on a banking platform, when you leave, you want to log off. But the attacker is already hijacked that session and continues after you have logged off. It's very difficult now to go to the bank and tell them it was not you. Because you logged in with your password, and the same time that you logged is this 2 minutes later you were hijacked. And you logged off after 15 minutes, but the attacker continued for another 10 minutes and transferred money. For you to go to the bank and convince them it was not you, it's very, very difficult. So the man-in-the-middle attack hijacks a session between a trusted client and network server. The attacking computer substitutes its IP address, and the trusted client, when they log off, the server still thinks they are serving the trusted client, and the attacker does his harmful things like that. IP spoofing. How do they get the IP address of the victim? They do IP spoofing. That is, they convince the system that they are the trusted ones. They use the credentials of the trusted client to connect, and they do their harmful work. Then there is another one, another method that they do, the replay method. They record whatever the victim is doing. They record everything, every detail. When the client has logged off, they use exactly the same information to trick the server to give them service. It's a replay. They're just replaying what this legitimate user was doing. They have managed to record everything from the username, passwords, everything. They just change maybe the account numbers where the money is going, and they get away with it. Now, what is the solution to this one, man in the middle? Currently, there's no single technology or configuration to prevent man in the middle attacks. At the moment, there's no solution. There's no solution, so to say. There's still men in the middle who still continue to cause problems. Encryption and digital certificates provide a safeguard against. They just provide a safeguard, but you cannot eliminate that threat. You cannot eliminate it completely. They just provide a safeguard that if the man in the middle tries to come in, there's digital certificates, there's encryption. You can encrypt your session between the client and the server, but still the man in the middle will still continue to haunt us. Man in the middle attack can be injected into the middle of communication in such a way that the encryption will not help. So even if there is encryption, it does not mean that it's 100% safe, because this type of attack, the encryption might not help, because our learned criminal might still find a way to go around it. Then the last one for today, I'm going to talk about phishing and spear phishing attacks. Phishing, just like in the real life fishing, where you put a bait on your hook, you throw it in the water, the fish see it, they think that, here comes food, they eat and they are caught. It's the same thing like what they do when they are fishing. They send you an email with very juicy information, very inviting, and it's looking like it's coming from people you know. It's coming from your manager, it's coming from your bank, it's coming from your mother, it's coming from your husband or your wife or someone or your friend, and it's inviting. By the time you click on it, there's an attachment on that email, it downloads on your computer, and it begins to cause havoc. So that email also can lead you to an illegitimate website. Let's say it's from a bank. They know that you're a millionaire and you bank with APSA. They just clone the APSA website. But behind it, the URL, they put their own code so that when you click on it, you are clicking thinking you're going to the APSA bank, and it looks like APSA, but in the background, you are going to their website. Once you connect to their website, they download all your personal information, which they can later use to siphon money from your bank. So this one, a phishing attack, is a very, very dangerous attack. This nowadays, because of social media, it also combines social engineering and technical trickery. It could involve an attachment to an email that loads malware onto your computer. So your email, it comes legitimate from the bank, like every month you receive your statement from the bank, and unknowing to you, maybe they send it just a day earlier before the actual one comes. 2 days earlier, they send you the phishing email. You are thinking, normally it's now month end, the bank is sending me a statement, you click on it, there you are. You are in trouble. It will also be a link to an illegitimate website that can trick you into download malware or handing over personal information. So if you now believe that it's from your bank and it's asking you for your username and password to verify, they just were verifying your username and password. Most of us, the ordinary user, will say, let me confirm that it's me. They are just doing a routine check, not knowing that it's a phishing software. So spear phishing is very targeted type of phishing activity. Attackers take time to conduct research. Criminals, cyber security criminals, have got time in their hand. They've got the skill, they're intelligent, and they've got time. And normally they are not suspected. So they've got all the time to study their victims. And they know you, they know your, they know you, they know you, they know you. Now, after they've studied you, they can create messages that are personal and relevant to you. They know that you applied for a loan, because they've been watching you, studying you. You applied for a loan online. And then they can fake a response to you. They know that you need that loan. And from there, you will not suspect that you are being phished. So, because of this, spear phishing can be very hard to identify and even harder to defend against. It's very hard to defend against spear phishing. One of the simplest ways a hacker can conduct a spear phishing attack is email spoofing, which is when the information in the from section of the email is falsified. They just go to your email, from email, they falsify it. When you say reply, you are replying to a fraudster. So another technique they use is to add do what is called website cloning to add credibility. If you are a student, you want to register and they want your personal information, they just clone your college's website and they say, now you are registering, give us your phone number, your ID address, your ID number, everything, your what you give it, thinking you are on a correct website. But no, they just cloned your college website. So these are some of the techniques. Finally, how do you reduce these phishing attacks or phishing risks? Critical thinking. Do not accept that an email is the real deal just because you are busy or stressed. Because sometimes emails, we open them unknowingly because we are busy and we think, this is the real thing. Hovering over the links, don't just click on links. Hover your mouse on that link. When you hover over a link, it will show you the URL, where it's supposed to go over a link, rather than just clicking. And you can see that it's no longer going to where it's supposed to. Then there you can safeguard. You must analyze the email headers, especially the reply to and the return path parameters. Reply to and the return path parameters. Because they can say, reply to us with these details. While it's in the reply path, it's going to the criminals. If you don't check that, then you are in problem. Sandboxing. You can test email content in the sandbox environment, logging activity from opening the attachment. All those are. Next time, we'll talk about drive-by attacks. So, students, before I close, let's go. This is the book that our lecture has been based on. You go to the last topic in this book. That is the topic we are talking about, internet security. If you go on to page 279, there is an individual activity there that you can do. There's a website there. Log into there and see what they want you to do there. And another one, we are also going to look at page 285 of the same textbook. There's another activity that you can do. Until we meet again the next time, please attend to that in this book, Level 4 Multimedia Service. Thank you very much for Level 4 students, Orbit College. We'll meet on the WhatsApp group and then we can discuss further. I'll give you contact information there on our WhatsApp group. Once again, thank you, thank you, thank you.